A very warm welcome to Civilspedia, Current Affairs Digital Library. Today we're going to see 24th June 2018 Current Affairs. In prelims topics, we're going to see Ambachi, Mela, then UN Space Plus 50, then Scots Award, then the last one in the prelims topic will be Tajikistan. And in editorial mains topics, we're going to see at the heart of the Silk Road. So this is regarding our BRI, okay? And we'll end up our session with the basis of vigilantism. See, the first is Ambachi Mela is a annual menstruation for the goddess, okay? It is a festival. It is a, regarding a menstruation cycle occurring for the goddess. And it is happening in the Kamakhya temple, which is located in the Neelchal Hills, Guwahati. That means it is in Assam. Okay? And this, the whole thing is regarding the fertility cult of the goddess Kamakhya. Fine. And Kamakhya is also considered as a tantric goddess of the Hinduism. One of the tantric goddess of the Hinduism. And this whole festival is considered as a Magakumbha of the East. Because lot of people are attracted. That means lot of devotees come for this Mela. Okay. And if you see this temple, the temple have no ideal. It has a only a vajna, like yoni like stone structure only. Okay. See, this is considered as one of the 51 Shakti Peeth and also one of the out of four major Shakti Peeth. See, Shakti Peeth is when Parvati died, the wife of the Shiva died, Shiva made a destructive dance. Okay. So the Parvati's overall body disintegrated into different parts. Okay. So one of them is Shakti Peeth. One among them is all the parts are called Shakti Peeth, and one among them is this Kamakhya temple. See, the social impact is important in this old Mela itself. See, we all know in our Indian society, menstruation cycle is considered as a taboo. Even talking about this is a not a good thing in our society. Okay. So this actually increasing the hygiene and health awareness regarding the menstruation cycle. So only in Assam, this taboo is less. Apart from this, recently, even this year, our Union Health Ministry started SI Bleed campaign. This is regarding the menstrual hygiene campaign. Okay. So this is full of Ambachi Mela. The next one is Unispace Plus 50. See, this is the celebration of 50th anniversary of the first United Nations conference regarding exploration and peaceful use of outer space. So outer space should not be used for any war kind of purposes or else to create a threat to the another country. Okay. So to celebrate this initiative, they have celebrated Unispace 50. And this happened in Vienna International Center. Okay. See, Unispace conference, it started with 1968. And after this, two other conferences held. Okay. And this is the fourth conference. One important thing is what they will do is they will analyze what was the past achievement and what shall be done in the future for the better utilization of the space technologies for the peacefulness of the overall world. Okay. And space 30 agenda, sorry, 2030 or else 2030 agenda will be the major topic in this Unispace 50. Because this agenda is regarding how we can use the outer space for implementation of the all 17 sustainable development goals. Okay. So this Unispace 50 will, what they will do is they will create a comprehensive framework, legalized framework for the space 2030. See, United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs deals with this overall Unispace 50 also regarding any peaceful act. It also act as a secretariat for many outer space activities, international level. Okay. International Global Navigation System also, it is acting as a secretariat. Okay. So what is relationship between this and India? See, India have a deal or a program with UN Small Satellites Program. Okay. See, this program is, what they will do is, they will train each year 30 engineers. Per year, they will train 30 engineers in the URL satellite center. It is right now it is called as ISAC. 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 This is a Bengaluru based satellite center. Okay. So every year 30 engineers will do the research in a single small satellite. So totally 3 years, 3 small satellite and 90 engineers. Okay. So this is regarding the Unispace plus 50. The next is SKOCH or SKOCH award. See, this award came in news because Ministry of Women and Child Development received this award for their initiative for the betterment of the humanity. Okay. Who give this award is SKOCH Consultancy Services. See, this is a think tank. Okay. This is a think tank which even works 1997. What they really do is they will celebrate the human excellence and agents change the overall Indian society. So anyone who contributes for the human excellence and changing of the Indian society will be facilitated. Okay. And this is considered as highest independently instituted civilian award. Which is the highest civilian award we can get? Any civilian is Bharat Ratna. That is the government award, correct? And what fields they will give this award is, they will give this award for governance, finance, even banking and the technology, corporate citizenship, economics and inclusive growth also. Okay. So this is regarding the SKOCH award. And the next is Tajikistan. See, Tajikistan came with news because a high level global conference held over there. Okay. The global conference is regarding International Decade for Action, where water for sustainable development. Okay. See, this, the period is 2018 to 2028. This has been recently initiated. So this decade is for the water for sustainable development. Okay. And this has been instituted in 2018 on the Water Day, World Water Day, 22nd March. Fine. See, we all know this is sustainable development goals. And the sixth sustainable development goal is clean water and sanitation. Please remember all 17 sustainable goals. It will be come handy while you are writing your mains as well as your prelims. Okay. So please remember all the sustainable goals. And Tajikistan, we'll see what is Tajikistan. See, Tajikistan joined in the Soviet Union in 1929 and they became independent in 1991. Once the Soviet Union broke down. Okay. The capital of the Tajikistan is Dushanbe. Okay. And Fergana Valley is a largest valley in the Tajikistan, which lies in the northern part of the Tajikistan. And Lake Karakul is the largest lake, which lies more than 13,000 mean sea level. Okay. We'll see the map of the Tajikistan. See, if you watch closely, Tajikistan shares borders with Kyrgyzstan. Correct. And also it shares borders with Uzbekistan. Okay. And even you see Afghanistan is there. And see the here Pakistan and China. We have very little distance. Okay. So Tajikistan is here and the capital is Dushanbe is here. So that's all regarding the prelims topics. We are getting into the editorial mains topics of the day. See, at the heart of the Silk Road, this article is purely regarding the BRI, Belt and Road Initiative. See, Belt and Road Initiative started in 2013 by Xi Jinping. Okay. He's the president of China. See, initially, this overall program had two things. One is Silk Road Economic Belt and Maritime Silk Road. These are the two programs. And these two programs merged and OBOR came into existence. One belt, one road. Okay. And this has been renamed BRI, Belt and Road Initiative. In fact, BRI has been taken as a one part, one of the constituent of the Chinese constitution. Okay. So that much importance Chinese or China is giving for the BRI. If you see, this is the overall map for the BRI. If you watch closely, what they are trying to do is they are trying to connect Asia with Europe and Africa. Okay. So this is the Silk Road Economic Belt. It's going through Middle East as well as it's getting into the Europe. Okay. And if you watch closely, the Maritime Silk Road, it's trying to go into the important straits. Malacca Strait, correct. And also it comes to India as well as the Sri Lanka, then it goes and links the Africa, and also it is going to the Europe. Okay. And see, Chinese overseas military base, Djibouti, recently it has been opened. Okay. This and all important thing. And one of the major contention between the India and the China is CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. Okay. That is also a major problem. Fine. So what are the significance? Why they need this Belt and Road Initiative? First and foremost is currency diplomacy. They can able to increase their important banks like Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. So this will become a prominent institution, financial institution, which lends money to most of the countries. And also, when you provide money, it is kind of a soft power. Correct? Can able to get hold of the other countries. Maritime power. This is going to create the overall China as a strong maritime power. And this is important for China, especially for the South China Sea, where so many people are trying to get hold of it. Okay. See, this is a kind of international significance. Even in domestic significance, western part of the China is not well developed when you compare with the eastern part of the China, like Xinjiang. Okay. So these areas will be developed highly. In fact, Xinjiang provinces are considered as the core zone of Silk Road. Okay. So this will increase their development for that China also. And the energy, all the energy routes going to be linked with this. So this will provide China a better connectivity for the energy routes, and also a sufficient and a viable energy routes. Market and trade. They're going to get new markets, okay? As well as they can able to counter recent TPP kind of regional groupings like Trans-Pacific Partnership. These things can be easily countered by the Belt and Road Initiative. So these are the important significance of the Silk Road. What are the challenges? Commercial viability. It needs a lot of investment. It's not a small project. So whether it's a commercially viable, that is the major question. And institutional. See, most of the time, it is considered as a actually Chinese or as only China based institutional. It is not a consensual or else there is no democracy in there. That is the another major problem. See, political stability. Fragile state index. It is an index which shows there are high political instability among the Syria, Afghanistan. So these are the area actually the Silk Road is getting into. So that may have a huge impact or a challenge on the BRI. See, apart from this, even this index shows there's an increase in the political instability on other countries also. Okay. Regional level, because there is no transparency and sometimes it is considered as a hegemony or a big brother attitude of the China towards the other small countries. So this is a dent on the sovereignty of the countries, small countries. So that may be the biggest challenge. So pursuing them. Okay. So pursuing them is the major problem. Long term, whether it can be a stable one in the long term, that is the major question, because it's going to affect sovereignty, or else it's going to be affected, or it's going to be seen as a negative influence on the other countries. If it is going to be seen like that, whether it is long term stable, or else whether the country can able to repay the amount, okay, whether they can reap the economic benefits, inclusive benefits, these are the major problem. And also, in the domestic level also, in Xinjiang provinces, there were terrorism. That is a important problem. And apart from this, there are armed groups are there, even Xinjiang and all, okay? After all this, environmental issue. Where world is going towards the very big climate change, we are encountering a important climate change things. This is going to need more of resources and more of constructions, more of destruction of the natural resources. How this is going to be facilitated, or else how it's going to be compensated. Okay, so these are the important challenges of the BRI. Okay, so what about India and Belt and Road Initiative? As I said earlier itself, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is the major problem or major bone of contention for the India and the China. See, apart from this, India says there is no transparency. And India also accused that China acting like an autocrat in this overall BRI. And that China is trying to get into the sovereignty of the other countries. See, if you watch closely, we have a string of pearls theory, where the string of pearls theory is China is trying to encounter or encircle the India in a maritime base. Okay. If you watch closely, these dotted lines are our string of pearls theory. Okay. So Cambodia, and if you see Amman Bota and Gwadar. Gwadar is a port in Pakistan. Okay. It is maintained by the China, and Djibouti, Sudan, all this, even Maldives. Right now, after this political problem with the Maldives, Maldives is trying to sideline with the China. Okay. This is a string of pearl theories, and string of pearl route is closely associated with the BRI. Okay. So this is also a major irritant for the India. So what India can do? That means like BRI is a very bad thing to India. No, there are even advantages for India in joining it. In fact, in the recent BRI meeting, except Bhutan, mostly all of them participated. Okay. And also, most of the Asian countries are the part of BRI. Apart very few like Bhutan, Japan, all are participants of the BRI. Okay. This will give economic increment or economic growth for India if they work with the BRI. And also, it will help us to solve the geopolitical problems. Because once we are part of BRI, even it has a investment from the China. Okay. So they also have a problem if this gets ruined. So they will try to make a peace efforts to create a peaceful coexistence. Okay. The future is at the juncture of our protectionism, where the biggest economic power, US, is trying to go for a protectionist attitude when they are actually imposing so many tariffs on the imports. This will act as a growth enabler, okay, for our Asia growth, overall Asia's developing growth. And also, because of this, so many countries are attaching to this Belt and Road Initiative. But the problem is whether it can able to stabilize itself and prove that they are the new world order. Okay, that is the major question, and we have to wait and watch for that. Okay, so that's all regarding the Belt and Road Initiative. The next is Badges of Vigilantism. Okay, see, in recent years, we can able to see there were lot of lynching and targeted mob violences on especially vulnerable groups. This inclusive for the minorities as well as the oppressed class. Okay, these reports are kind of a daily activity. Okay, so in this point of view, we have to see what is the reason for this and what is the solution for this. Correct. See, the mob lynching means it is kind of killing someone by a mob, a small mob or a big mob, where he has been accused of an offense. Okay, but he won't be given any platform to try it upon or else to tell his view. Okay, they will not allow the principle of jurisprudence. Okay, or else due process of law is not at all followed. If someone has been alleged that he killed someone, immediately the justice will be done, or else like it is not justice, actually immediately action will be taken. Okay, so without the normal process of law, killing someone by a mob is called as mob lynching. Okay. In fact, 86% of the people were killed in lynching incidents in 2017. That means if 100 people attacked by the any accusation, 86 of them are beaten to death. Okay. This is actually given by India Spend, a report India Spend. This is very bad. So the mob is, the ultimate intention is nowadays, it is a cruel punishment, death. Okay. See, we are not free from the history of incidents of this overall violence. But if you see the violence, it is used to be in the Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Jharkhand, Haryana, Gujarat, West Bengal. These were the place where the religion polarization is very high. Okay. Even citizens against aid. Okay. This gave out a lynching without end. This is a report gave out by the Citizens Against Gate, it's an NGO. This says 97% of violence or lynching due to the cow killing, okay, happened after BJP came into power. So this shows there is a surge in the attack, especially in the name of cows, okay. And see, the major part right now is the South Asia is always infamous for the mass violence or religious violence. But right now what happened is there is no mass religious violence. Rather, it's going for a small level lynching where few people, maybe like 10-20 people, kill one or two guys. This is becoming a localized incident. Okay, if it is a localized incident, there may be high chances of repetition, and you need so much of force to control it. Okay, that is the major problem if a mass violence is turning into a character shift. And the problem is the intensity won't be noted. It is considered as, because we don't know whether to consider as a normal attack or else a hate attack. The differentiation itself a problem. So what are the reasons? The reasons is high polarization. Recent high polarization, and especially high hate speech, that too people who were in the power, who were in a very important positions, they can able to go for it. These are the main reasons, and also inaction by the government. Judicial process is very lengthy one, and there are lot of times where victims have to wait so much of time to get at least justice. And most of the time what happens is the predator or like the accused gone without any punishment. This reduces the overall belief in the system itself. The impacts are huge. It is not a small level impact, because the impact is psychological level also. It shows that people no more believe in the due process of law, or else law shows that they cannot allow any protection to the people, common man. Okay, so this will erode the base of the democracy itself. Okay, and also it will erode the people's belief in the government itself. What shall be done? Absolutely, the first and foremost thing is the hate speech or the polarization speech should be contained immediately, and any hate crime or else this kind of lynching should be fast tracked in terms of integration as well as the final judgment. These are the important thing. And apart from this, all this ethics and morals is the solution for everything. Okay, whenever you write your mains paper, please note down and please try to write some important things, and this may have high chances of coming. These kind of questions may come in your ethics paper also, GS4. Okay, so that's all for today. Thanks for watching.